Well, hello to all of you. It's good to see you this morning. Good to connect with those of you that are online. Continue prayers for Pastor Nathan. He's just a little under the weather. Nothing like last time that he wasn't here. Just not feeling the best. But you were scheduled to get me regardless whether he was here or not. So I've had a little bit more time than 26 minutes, I think, was the last time that I preached to you. So I probably shouldn't have told you that, because now if it doesn't go so well, I don't have that to blame it on. No, but it's good to be here with you, to get to share with you today. We have been in a series called Soul Care, and this is the third week of the series. And the first week, Pastor Nathan talked about good news and talked about us looking up, expecting more, and receiving strength. And I hope that that was an encouraging word to you, and you've been doing your best to walk in that with God's help. And then last week, we talked about gratitude, having the attitude of gratitude. And again, hopefully you've had opportunities this week to express gratitude, not just to the Lord, but to others. And this week, we are going to talk a little bit about confidence. And anybody here ever been overconfident? Let's just start that way. Anybody admit to ever being overconfident? Yeah. Well, oftentimes that doesn't get us, sometimes that can get us in the deep weeds, being overconfident. And I'm about to share a story with you that everything within me is telling me not to share this. But I'm going to tell it anyway. So we've got four kids, two girls, two boys. And if you're the dad of a boy, probably, I'm going to stereotype, but probably most of you understand, like, roughhousing with your boys and having fun that way. You might wrestle. You might have contests with them. You might arm wrestle with them. Whatever. You just do that kind of stuff as they grow up. And when they're little, like, I can remember arm wrestling is, I don't know, it's become a thing in our house, I guess. But I can remember, you know, when they're little, you kind of get up there and you let them move your arm. And honestly, when they're little, you usually even let them win. At least I did a lot when they were real little. And then they start to get older and they start to give a little bit more resistance, you know, and you might still let them win for a little bit, but they know, they're starting to get older and they know that dad's really got them, you know, but they're gonna keep doing that. And then they hit junior high and get one little chest hair and hit puberty and think that they are just going to dominate everybody and everything that they come in contact with. And then the trash talking starts. And that's when, maybe you're a much better dad than I am, but that's when you just let reality sink into your kid. And when you come to arm wrestle, you're just like, nope, come back and try again next week, next year, whatever. We're done playing that little game. Well, speaking of overconfidence, it's been a little while since I've arm wrestled with my oldest, and he's 17 now, and the last, you know, year plus, he's been lifting and bulking up and all that kind of stuff, and I've been trying to bulk down. But anyway, the other day, just off the cuff, we were probably going back and forth a little bit like we do, and I said, "You want to arm wrestle?" Being a little maybe overconfident. And do you know that sometimes when you're overconfident, you might miss some of the little things that make a difference? So I said to my son Noah, "All right, let's arm wrestle." And I just flopped down at the table, not thinking that my elbow doesn't really have much of a resting point, not thinking that I was at a bad angle, not thinking about, I didn't have any shoes on, and my socks on the wood floor didn't really give me anything to brace against. I've got all kinds of excuses, by the way. A whole lot more even that I'm thinking as they're coming to mind. But he beat me. Trust me, this will not be the last time we arm wrestle. This is not the end of the story. There will be a day. Yes. But my overconfidence got the best of me. I knew I should See, now I'm contributing to his overconfidence. But my overconfidence got the best of me. By being overconfident, I didn't think about all those little choices, all those little things that could lead to my demise instead of my victory. And there's a spiritual application of that, and we're gonna talk about it today. And we might tend to be long on self-confidence. We might even tend at times to be overconfident. Many of us may be guilty of that. But my opinion would be that maybe more often than not, it goes the other way. That oftentimes we are short on confidence. That oftentimes we might have low self-esteem, or there might be doubts that keep us from entering into many things in life. They might, and it might even keep us from following God's call or God's leading that he has for us. Things that he wants us to step into, things that he wants us to enter into. It might keep us from that. But I think the biggest problem isn't that we're short on self-confidence, but that we are short on God confidence. We're short on the confidence that we need to have in our Heavenly Father. And it can be difficult these days to be positive and confident about ourselves in the right way, confident in who God has created us to be, and it doesn't take much to set off our insecurities, quite honestly. We might tend to fill our hearts and minds with negative self-think and negative self-talk, and that lack of confidence, that low self-esteem, whatever, it can manifest itself in a lot of different ways. And some ways that we might see insecurity or low self-confidence manifest itself. You might know of or have people around you who are people pleasers. And oftentimes people pleasing comes because of low self-esteem, low confidence. I want to check and see and kind of test the winds of the people around me to see what they think in order to decide what I'm going to do. We might call them wind checkers. You might also know people that around you that are what we might call fishers. They're always seeking compliments. If I'm low in self-esteem, if I don't have a strong self-worth in a positive way, I might always be trying to get others to say positive things about me to help boost that up a little bit. Or you might know people who are one-uppers. No matter what somebody does or no matter what somebody else says, there's always the, oh yeah? Well, let me tell you about whatever it might be for me, what I did or what happened to me, always trying to one-up others. But in addition to manifesting in these ways, being insecure can rob us of obeying God and following his dreams and callings in our lives. It might let those voices creep in, that doubt creep in that says, don't do this or that. You won't succeed. You can't do this. You never will. Whatever it might be. But in light of all that, what we don't need, we do not need more self-confidence. Because self-confidence can just lead to overconfidence, which we've already talked about a little bit, which can sometimes be funny in the story I told, but it can also be devastating in other areas. We don't need more self-confidence. What we need to do is cultivate more God confidence. So we're going to talk a little bit about God confidence today. I'm going to start with 1 Corinthians 10, verse 12. It says that, so if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. When we live in too much self-confidence, there's that potential for us to fall. There's that potential for us to not hit the mark in more ways than just arm wrestling. I like the way it says it in 1 Corinthians 10, 12, in the Message, it says, don't be so naive and self-confident. You're not exempt. You could fall flat on your face as easily as anyone else. Forget about self-confidence. It's useless. Cultivate God confidence. Sounds easy enough, right? close the book, say amen. We'll see y'all next week. Just go home and cultivate some God confidence. That's all you need. I think it sounds pretty easy. But we all know that in reality, like in a lot of areas, there tend to be these barriers that can come against doing things that God wants us to do spiritually. There's going to be barriers to developing God confidence. And before we move on to some of the building blocks of that God confidence, I want to talk a little bit about some of the things that might hinder us, that might keep us from getting there, some God confidence blockers, if you will. Well, one of the things that can keep us from developing God confidence is the fact that the human heart can be deceitful. Jeremiah 17:9 says, "The human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is?" Our heart, if we're not careful, can lead us astray. Anybody ever follow your emotions and your heart and got led astray? You know, it sounds good to say, always just follow your heart. Well, I don't know about you, but there are times in my life where if I follow my heart, it gets me messed up. Because my heart doesn't always think with God's wisdom. Let's just put it that way. Hearts and emotions can lead us the wrong way, and God's word tells us that our hearts can be deceitful at times. So our heart can be deceitful, and that can pose a barrier. But I would also say that because our flesh can be weak, that can pose a barrier as well. Matthew 26, verse 41 says, "Keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the body is weak." But the body is weak. Our flesh is weak on our own. We really aren't that strong when we try and stand on our own stuff, on our own strength, on our own confidence, because we often give in to temptation. Anybody ever make some sort of commitment or something and doesn't take long before we give in, we fall short. Temptation comes our way, and we might take the easy way out or the way that might look best for us, or maybe it's the most comfortable. Maybe it's a way that seems to even make the most sense. But it's not always God's way, and that temptation can come and entice us because on our own standing and in our own strength, the flesh is weak. A third obstacle or God confidence blocker might be that, honestly, sometimes our behavior is just inconsistent. Romans 7:15, Paul says, "I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate." That can be a confusing passage if you read all of it, all the, "I do this, but I don't want to do this, I don't want to do this, but I do this." And that's Paul, who we look to as, you know, man, this God-fearing, God-following, wonderful man of God. And he says those things. So if he's dealing with that, we probably deal with that too. But our behavior is so consistent. And when our behavior is consistent and we keep doing the things we don't want to do and we don't do the things we know we should do, man, it can be really hard to develop some of that God confidence, right? So we've got to be careful about who or what we put our confidence and trust in. So with saying all that, is there really any hope for us today? Is it all doom and gloom? No, it is not. And obviously, I would not be here today. I would not be sharing with you if that was the end of the story, because there is hope. And even though there could be some barriers to developing God confidence, there are definitely some builders to God confidence that we can stand on as well. And hopefully, we can say with the psalmist in 57:7, "My heart is confident in you, O God. My heart is confident. No wonder I can sing your praises." Hopefully today, by the time we're done, that we can walk out of here living that verse out, that we can walk out of here so confident in who God is in our lives, that we can walk singing God's praises, that I don't have to be concerned. So some promises from Scripture that we can stand on as we're attempting to build God confidence. It's easy to preach. It's easy to say, I need to build confidence. But what are some things that I can stand upon? What are some things that I can grasp hold to as I'm attempting to do this, as I'm attempting to get out of the self-confidence realm and into the God-confidence realm? Well, one thing is we can stand on God's word and know that God is for you. God is for me. Romans 8:31 says, "What shall we say about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can ever be against us?" If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Regardless of what you think, God is not out to get you. Sometimes we can get this idea in our head of God being God is just waiting for us to mess up, smack us upside the head. He's waiting for us to mess up and tell us how horrible we are. He's waiting for us to mess up and say, "See, you didn't live up to my word once again." And there's lots of variables, lots of reasons why we might get to that point. But that's not truth. Those are things that the enemy throws at us. The truth is that God is for us. And if he's for us, who can ever be against us? Think of what we want for our children that God's gifted to us. Even after he beat me in arm wrestling, I still wanted the best. Well, a little bit after he beat me in arm wrestling, I still wanted the best for my son. Even after our kids mess up, we still love them. We still cherish them. We still want the best for them. And if we want that for our kids, what do you think God wants for us? Do you think he's not for us simply because we fall short one time? Do you think he's not for us because we mess up? No, God is for us. And if that's the case, who can ever be against us? And for those of us that have faith in Jesus, who have made that commitment, who God calls us his children, we are free not to live for the approval of God, but to live from the approval of God. Did you get that? We're free not to live for the approval of God. We are free to live from the approval of Father God. Because he's my father, he approves of me. Now, does that mean I don't mess up and I don't need discipline? No. He disciplines those he loves. He keeps transforming and changing us, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But because I'm his child, there is a place of approval there. There is a place of love. There is a place of love that we cannot begin to imagine. He is for us. Hebrews 10:35 says, "So do not throw away this confident trust in the Lord. Remember the great reward it brings you." So keep your dreams alive. Live and know that he will enable you to do what he has called you to do. That is how great his love is. He is for you, and he's not going to call you to something that he doesn't want you to succeed at. He's not going to call you to something that he hasn't enabled you to do. So God is for us, and that should be enough. But I'm going to give you a couple more just because I'm a pastor and we're supposed to have three-part sermons, so I'm going to give you three. So he's for me, but two is that God always helps me. God always helps you. Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6 says, "Don't love money, be satisfied with what you have, for God has said," and here's the key part, "I will never fail you, I will never abandon you." So we can say with confidence, "The Lord is my helper, so I will have no fear. What can mere people do to me?" I will never fail you, and I will never abandon you. He's going to lead you to where he's called you to go. And you may feel unsure, a little bit doubtful, but he's going to help you. Tell him what you need. His Bible says, his word says that if we need wisdom, that we're to ask for it, right? Pastor Nathan often refers to breath prayers. We just need to pray out that breath prayer, "Help." The same way that Peter did when he was sinking and he needed Jesus to step in. That simple, "Help. Jesus, save me." You might need strength. You might need the right words, the right attitude, the right thoughts. You might need faith. You might need peace. But God tells us in his word that he will never leave us or forsake us. He has not abandoned us, and that he is always there to help. Again, coming from Psalms 46, Verse 1, God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. I don't know about you, but I love stories of the underdog. I love stories where there's no rhyme or reason why somebody should be victorious, why somebody should come out on top, whether it's sports movies like Hoosiers or, you know, The Miracle on Ice, those types of things. But also within the Bible, and the story of David and Goliath gets used to illustrate a lot of things. But I think about that story as I'm thinking about confidence and overconfidence, self-confidence, God confidence, and has all of it. I think about Goliath. I think about how he was brimming with self-confidence, and understandably so, given his size and his stature and his victories and all that. But I think about David too in that case. And I don't have this up on the screen, but I'm going to share with you. As David goes to meet Goliath, he says, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands." David knew all about God confidence, right? David knew that no matter what the odds were, that if his confidence was in the Lord, he would be victorious. That if he followed God's leading, that he could step into the craziest of situations. And if you don't know the story of David and Goliath, go read that this week. But for those that know the story, you know that is a crazy situation. I don't care how much self-confidence you have, you do not step into that expecting to come out victorious. But David had so much God confidence. He knew these promises of God. He knew that God was not only for him, but he was going to be there literally to help him as he stepped into the unknown, as he stepped into the scary, as he stepped into the things that quite honestly looked like would end his life. He had the God confidence to step into it and to come out victorious. Some of you may have been in a struggle. Maybe you're currently in a struggle and you don't realize that God has been helping you all along. I encourage you to look back, review, look at it. Look for those small ways. Look for the things that maybe weren't real obvious to you before and see that God has been helping you all the way along. Just because he didn't do things your way doesn't mean that he wasn't and isn't working in your situation. So think about that and declare his goodness. So one, God is for me. His word tells me that. God always helps me. His word tells me that. And thirdly, God is still working in me. You might have asked the question, how could God ever use someone like me? Someone like you? Because I know me, and quite honestly, I don't even always like myself. I'm a real piece of work. Anybody ever tell you that? You are a piece of work. That's exactly it. You are a piece of work. I am a piece of work. Philippians 1, verse 6 tells us that. And I am certain that God, who began the good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. We are a work in progress. God is continually working in us. So even when I might struggle with developing that God confidence, maybe I'm struggling with my own confidence and I'm like, I'm not good enough. He would never use me. All those types of things. We can know that where I'm at today, God's not going to leave me there. He's going to take me to a new place tomorrow and another place after that. And he's going to continue to work and move within my life, in me and through me, until my time is done. He will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. I'm a piece of work. You're a piece of work. Tell somebody that this week and see how they respond to you. Dude, you are a piece of work. And then when they're about ready to hit you, tell them exactly what you mean. God is continuing to move and work in our lives even when we don't see it. Sometimes we have to look at things differently to see results. Results are usually what motivate us, right? Give us confidence. Maybe we don't always see the way that God's working. Maybe we need to look at it differently. I've been up and down over the years with trying to lose weight, gaining it back, trying to lose weight, gain it back. And one thing that we can often fall victim to if we're working out, trying to do certain things, is we got this picture in our mind where we want to end up, and we know where we're at. And so we go do something for a little while. Maybe we lift, maybe we run, maybe we work out, whatever. And we don't see the results right away. And so we don't think anything's happening. Well, like I said, I've been on that yo-yo. And in my latest round here, I decided I needed to do something different. I went and I bought a scale. Reason being, because I knew that if I just relied on looking in the mirror, that there would be many, many days where I didn't feel like anything was happening. But if I bought a set of scales and I stepped on those, that often showed me things that were happening that I couldn't see with my eye. And it's the same way spiritually, that oftentimes God is working and moving and doing things within us that we might not be able to see. We may not be looking at it from the right perspective, but He is continually working and moving, and He is making progress with us. Even when we don't understand it, even when we don't see it, even when we feel like we don't think He's even there, He is working. Because His word says that He who began a good work within you will continue His work until it's finally finished. Not continue it until He gets tired of it. Not continue with it until you mess up X number of times and then He's done. No, He's going to continue it until it's finished. He's not finished with you, He's not finished with me, and He never will be on this side of heaven. So, if you're struggling today, maybe with spiritual doubts, maybe you've got that nagging habit that you just can't seem to overcome, maybe you've had a difficult time getting with the Lord and getting His word in you, and you don't think He's doing anything, I want you to go back to the scripture and know that even on the most difficult days, hold to the promise that He is continuing His work in you until it is finally finished. That the days where you don't feel like you can keep going, where you've been doing this over and over and over again, and it's just not getting anywhere, there's no results, I can't see anything happening, trust that God is working in you to complete what He started. I may have a hard time completing things that I start. God doesn't have a hard time completing the things that He starts. He knows where you've been, and He knows where He's taken you to. And He's not all worked up about it. He's not anxious about it. He's not stressed out about it. He knows the plans that He has for you, and He's moving you towards them. So go ahead and step into that confidence that God just might not, He might just know what He's doing. He might just be the God of the universe that's got the perfect plan in place, and I can just relax and trust in that. Colossians 1, verses 4 through 5, as we're rounding the corner here, says, "For we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and your love for all of God's people, which come from your confident hope of what God has reserved for you in heaven. You have had this expectation ever since you first heard the truth of the good news." Faith in Christ Jesus, which came from a confident hope of what God has reserved for you in heaven. God wants us to walk in God confidence. He wants us to walk knowing that He is for us, that He's going to help us, and that He's not finished with us. I don't know how many of you have ever played sports, have ever been competitive, but I think about times where I might have been on the playground, I might have been on the ball field, and there may have been a little bit of doubt there. There may have been a little bit of worry maybe about the other team and about who we were coming up against. Maybe you're a little kid and that other team looks really big to you, really scary. And then maybe the best kid on the playground, maybe a big brother, maybe even a coach or somebody comes along and steps onto your team. And all of a sudden, instead of looking down, instead of being a little concerned, instead of having that doubt, all of a sudden now your chest sticks out a little bit more. Your stance gets a little bit straighter. Because you know that big guy that just stepped onto your team. You know that that stud athlete who's usually on the other team is now on your team. You know that he's got your back. You know that even if you mess up, that he's good enough, that we're still going to win. I don't know if you've ever experienced that. To put it maybe in bigger terms, if you were on the basketball court and Michael Jordan stepped onto your team, does that raise your confidence level a little bit? He's still the greatest of all time. Don't give me any other names. He's still the greatest. Anyway, but it's that feeling. It's knowing that you have truly the GOAT, the greatest of all time, the Heavenly Father that's got your back. He's not just saying, I'm for you, sitting in the stands. He's saying, I'm for you, but I'm also going to help you. I'm not just a cheerleader, but I'm coming alongside you, and I'm going to walk with you through this. And as if that wasn't enough, he's also saying, I'm going to continue this work in you. So not only am I for you and I'm going to help you, but I'm going to help you to keep getting better and better. And that's something that you can have confidence in. You can walk in confidence knowing that the God of the universe is on your side, and you don't have to doubt or wonder. You don't have to doubt or wonder what the outcome is going to be. Because when I follow him, when I walk in the steps and the path that he's laid out for me, I know without a doubt that the outcome is going to be good. It might even look completely different than what I expected, but it's going to be good because it comes from him. Right? We don't define good, he does. But we can know when it comes from his hands, it is good. So maybe you need to take some of these scriptures and you need to start reciting them to yourself on a daily basis. Maybe when you get up in the morning, you look in the mirror, and maybe most days there's a little bit of self-doubt. Maybe there's a little bit of low self-esteem. God doesn't want you just to puff yourself up with self-confidence. He wants you to get a hold of God confidence. And so speak these words over yourself. Speak these verses over yourself and know that these promises are for you. As children of God, these promises are for you. And if you're not a child of God, if you're saying, Joel, I'd love to have this God confidence, but I don't know this God you're talking about, today's the day to know him. Today's today to open your heart and say, God, I want that. God, I want you in my life. I'm tired of relying on myself, doing it my own way, because that's fallen short. I need you, God, in my life. You can do that today. And we got people that would love to pray with you, to pray you through that. But maybe you need to start speaking some of this over yourself, saying, God is for me. He is helping me, and he is still working on me. I am a piece of work. You are a piece of work that God is continuing to craft together, and you can take confidence in that. Maybe you need to recite the 23rd Psalm over yourself, and I'm going to read it here, and I'm going to read it from the Message version, a pastor's paraphrase. Since I know the shepherd, I do not need to fear anything. I do not need to fear poverty, for I shall not want. I do not fear loneliness, because he is right here with me. I do not fear making mistakes, for he guides me in paths of righteousness. I do not fear failure, fatigue, distress, or depression, for he restores my soul. I do not fear the future, for goodness and mercy are following me all the days of my life. I do not even fear death, for I will live in God's house forever. God is beneath me in green pastures. He's beside me in still waters. He is with me in the valleys. He is around me, anointing my head with oil. He is before me leading me in the right path. He is behind me with goodness and mercy. He is far beyond me in heaven, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What more could I ever want? I don't know about you, but I could get a little bit excited about that, and I could take some confidence in that God. I could take some confidence in knowing that there's a God that loves me enough to give me those words to know that I can rest and trust in Him and who He is. But I have to walk out of here today, and I have to walk back to my normal day-to-day life, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Joel. So how do I do this? You keep that word in you and in front of you. You keep that perspective in front of you so that when you walk into those situations, when you walk into those struggles, when you wake up in the morning wondering what this day is going to bring, you can walk in God confidence knowing that He's got your back. You can know that you're walking onto the playground with the biggest, baddest, best athlete behind you, and there's no game coming at you that you're not going to have victory in because He's right there with you. That's what you can have walking with God, walking with Jesus. That's the confidence that He wants us to experience, that He wants us to walk in each and every day. Maybe you've got a financial struggle. Maybe there's a relationship struggle. Maybe there's something you're supposed to step into that you're a little bit concerned about. Maybe there's a work situation, whatever it might be. God's saying, don't walk in it in your own strength. Don't walk in it in your own self-doubt and worry and low self-esteem. He's saying, walk in it with the proper, positive God confidence that you can have when you walk with me. I'm going to ask you to stand, if you will. The team's here, and they're going to play. And as they do, I'd invite you, these altars, these stairs are open. Maybe something that was shared this morning has spoken to you. Maybe you need to step into this God confidence. Maybe you need to stop relying on self. Maybe you've had troubles with self-esteem and kind of the view of yourself, and God wants you to have that positive God perspective of yourself. He wants you to walk in the God confidence that He has for you. Maybe you don't know God. Maybe you've never asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, but you want to do that today. I invite you, as we sing a little bit, if you want to come forward, pray about that, pray about anything, you're welcome to do that. But know, man, God has so much in store for you. God wants so much for you. All we have to do is step out to Him. Ask Him for help. Ask Him to help us walk in the God confidence that He has for us. Well, Jesus, we thank You for the gathering that we've had this morning. We thank You for Your word that promises us, and it is a promise that we can be guaranteed of. It promises us that You are for us. It promises us that You will walk with us, that You will help us. And Your word promises us that You are not finished with us, that we are a work in progress, and that You will continue. You will continue to transform us day to day as long as we have breath. That You will continue to help us to look more and more like You each and every day as we surrender ourselves to You. And those are promises that we can walk in, that we can walk with God confidence because we know Your word is true. We know, God, without a doubt, that You love us in a way that we cannot imagine. You want the absolute best for us. So help us to walk in that today, Lord, I pray. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.